Hey, hey, it's Tamara here. Welcome to another episode of my tutorial series about making a farm game in Unity, or as you may know it, making HayDay. In this episode, we will develop a whole new mechanic for the game, farming. We will take a look at how planting works and get to know how to use the previously developed systems to work with this one. This system will include UI drag with collisions with objects in the scene, using interfaces for flexibility, so you can reuse this system for other features like feeding animals, and most importantly, a complete life cycle of a crop. To recap, in the previous episode we started developing a crucial system for the game, a storage system. It is not finished yet and we won't be developing it in this episode, but we will be using some parts of it. The completion of this system will be in the next episode of Making HayDay, so subscribe to my channel and turn on the notifications to not miss out on new episodes. Just a reminder that we're going to build upon what we already have, so if you haven't seen my previous videos, check them out. And if you just want to skip rewriting code, there is always my Patreon. You can support me there and get the project files with the source code from my tutorials. Before we get to the tutorial, this video is sponsored by UniTabs. Do you ever find yourself in a situation where you try following a tutorial like this one and you have lots of tabs with the video, code, and a browser to look things up, and switching between them is getting so annoying? I have a solution for you. Meet UniTabs. With this asset, you can dock almost any application within Unity. You can use it to have a reference side by side, to see if your new sprite fits, or even when you're creating textures and light maps. But you know what I like about it? When I'm fixing bugs, I can have my browser window, my IDE, and my scene at the same time. To start using it, first you have to import it from the Unity Asset Store. The link is going to be in the description. Then you'll see a new button on the top panel in Unity called Tools. Click on it, select UniTabs, and then you have a few options here. When you're first docking an application, you have to specify the path to its executable file. Let it open, minimize it, and move the tab around so it'll stick. When you have it in place, it's gonna always stay on top of the Unity window. After you've finished working, you can stop the service. If you leave the service running, your apps will auto-start the next time you open Unity. This asset can run multiple tabs at the same time because it is based on if your computer has enough RAM and processing power to run multiple applications. But I still recommend having a bit more powerful computer. Mine is not, so I couldn't get Photoshop to run, but my IDE and browser ran smoothly. And now, let's get to coding. First of all, let's look at how things work in the original game. As you can see, we have these field objects which actually behave like regular placeable objects, so our field script will have to inherit from the class we wrote before. Now, when you click on a field, we get a list of crops that we can plant. This is going to be a tooltip. Each crop can be dragged, and when it is over an empty field, it will get populated. A crop takes time to grow. For this, we'll use our timer which we already developed. It has a very similar tooltip to the one you see in HayDay. After the timer is finished, crop can be collected. If we click on a ready field, we get another tooltip for collecting. It will act similarly, but instead of planting, it will collect. Now, in HayDay, this dragging mechanic persists throughout the game. It is also used for harvesting trees and bushes, collecting animal produce, feeding, etc. So we have to develop this system in such a way that it can be used to create other mechanics as well. This is exactly why we're gonna use an interface to ensure this functionality. A few things you should know, I switched to a newer version of Unity in this episode, so things might look a bit differently than they did before. Project files on my Patreon will also be coming out with settings of a newer version from now on. It won't affect much in terms of how things function in your project. First of all, you have to create a prefab of a field. It is simple, just like any other placeable object we created before. It has a sprite and a polygon collider. Now, in your storage system folder, create another one called Sources and create a field script in it. Open it in the editor. Make the field class inherit from a placeable object. Create a static dictionary for all crops. Next, create a static int amount and set it to 2. This is the default amount of crops produced. It can change depending on some events that you might want to implement in your game. After this, create a field for a sprite render and an empty field sprite. In the awake method, get the sprite render component and save the empty field sprite. Create a public static void initialize which will accept a dictionary of crops. Assign the crops dictionary to the field all crops in this class. Now, create a protected override void onClick. Write something in debug just for testing. If you're getting an error here, you need to go back to placeable object script and create a virtual method which can be called in the method onMouseUp as button. Go back to the editor, find the field prefab and add the script to it. Fill in the size of a field. In the item types folder, create a script called producible. Open it in your IDE. Make it inherit from a collectible item. Then create a list for collectible items and call it item types. Then create another list with ints called item amounts. Dictionaries are not serializable, so you can't make them visible in the editor, so this is a way to populate a dictionary. We'll use the data from these two lists to populate the dictionary. Next, create a struct called time period. In it, make int fields for all time values like hour, minute, and so on. Above the declaration of this struct, write system.serializable in square brackets. This will ensure that it is visible in the editor. Create a field of type time period and call it in time struct. Then create a public dictionary with collectible items and integers called items needed. Create a time span for production time. Next, create a method onValidate. Since this is a scriptable object, this is one of the available lifecycle methods of it. It will be called after you modify values on this asset. In this method, initialize dictionary items needed. In a loop, add all items and amount from those two lists. Next, initialize the time spent from the data from the time struct. Now, go to the crop script and make it inherit from producible. Also, create two sprite fields for a growing crop and a ready crop. Then, create a new private void onValidate, call base onValidate method and then initialize the items needed dictionary with this and one. Crops will always take one instance of the same object. You plant a crop, you harvest the same crop. Go to the editor. Create a scriptable object shop item for the field so we can get it in our shop and place it on the map. Now you can enter the play mode and test your field quick. Moving on to the next step. Create another folder in the storage system called Sources UI. We're going to store our tooltips here. Create scripts called UI Drag, Distributor, and Collector. Open them. We'll start with UI Drag. In the declaration, make it implement interfaces. Begin drag handler, end drag handler, and drag handler. Create all required methods for these interfaces. Draw on begin drag, on drag, and on end drag. Create a static field of type canvas and call it the same. Then create a rectransform field, a canvas group, and an image. They're all needed to handle the drag. Next, create a vector 3 to save the origin position. It'll help us return the UI element on its original place. Also, we need to save the source this UI belongs to. It is going to be a placeable object. After these fields, create a public void initialize which accepts a placeable object source. Initialize the source field in this method. Create the awake method. Here we are going to get all the components we need. This includes getting rectransform, canvas group, and image. Also, save the origin position. Now, let's get to the drag methods. On begin drag, we'll first set the bold drag to true, then get a bold field from canvas group called blocks raycasts and set it to false. Also, set the pan zoom script enable to false so we don't accidentally move the map. Set the bold maskable on the image to false. I actually forgot to do it, so I did later. On drag, update the anchor position on a rectransform. Add to it a ratio between delta from the event data and canvas scale factor. On end drag, we're going to revert what we did on begin drag, so set all those bools to the opposite of what you did previously. Also, set the anchored position to the origin position. Create a protected virtual void on collide which accepts a placeable object. Now you can see me creating a fixed update method and checking for drag. But I realized that it can be done in the method onDrag, which is definitely a better place for it, so you should put it there. Now, what you're doing here is raycasting from the point the object is at and checking for a collision. From the hit, we get a placeable object component. Then we compare the type of the collided object and the one which belongs to this UI. If they match, we call the method onCollide. Moving on to the next script, distributor. It's gonna have a generic initialize method where t is a producible. It will accept a placeable object source, an item type of t, and an integer amount, which is going to have a default value -1. In it, call the base initialize and pass the source. Then initialize the item to produce and items needed, which you get from the item. Also, get the icon image and set it to the one you have on an item. Get the amount text transform. Next, check if amount equals to -1. If it does, we should disable the amount object because it means we don't need it. Otherwise, enable this object and set the amount. At the end, enable the whole object. Also, override method onCollide. We're going to start production here. Now, head to the collector class, make an inherit from the UI drag, and override the method onCollide. Let's look at the tooltips UI. First, we have an item holder with an amount text and an arrow. Attach the distributor script to this prefab. Next, we have an items tooltip. It has an invisible background, which is going to trigger closing the tooltip. Items tooltip object has a mask with the same shape as the tooltip cone. It has three item holders as children. Finally, we have a collect tooltip. It is very similar to items tooltip, but collector holder is not a prefab and we will have a collector script component. As for the scripts, create an items tooltip script and a collector tooltip. We'll start with the items tooltip. This is going to be similar to a tooltip we created for a timer. So it's going to have a static instance and a serialized private UI camera. But also it'll have a list of game object holders. In the awake, we initialize the instance and disable the tooltip object. It needs to be on when you first start the game so it can be initialized. But we're disabling the parent object because this script will be attached to a child object. Create a generic showTooltip method where t is a producible. It'll accept a game object caller and a dictionary with items. In it, create an int I and set it to 0. In a for each loop, go through items in the dictionary. Using I as an index, initialize each item holder by getting the distributor component and calling the initialize method. Pass parameters. Get placeable object from the caller object, collectible item from key, and a value. Increase the counter and check if it doesn't go out of bounds of item holders list. Next, we're going to have the position the tooltip where it should be. Get the color position and subtract the camera position. Then call screen to world point on your camera and pass the position converting with transform point method. Assign this new position to the transform position. And then set it active. In the hide tooltip method, disable all item holders and then disable the whole parent project. Now, we're going to create static methods for these two. It's just calling the same method. Now, as for the collector tooltip, I'm not going to explain it in detail because it is basically the same, but even simpler. If you want, you can create a base tooltip script and put these methods there, but I didn't want to refactor too many things in this project, and I'm not planning on making any more tooltips. But a base class is probably the best solution, so we don't write the same code too many times. Then, go to the storage manager and call the static initialize method on the field and pass crops dictionary. This will ensure that you will have crops to see in the tooltip. Go to the editor and create a crop instance. Fill in the fields. Also, add the items tooltip and collector tooltip scripts to their prefabs. Pay attention, you have to add these to the first child on the prefab object and not the background itself. Moving on to the actual lifecycle of the field. First, create a script called state and isource. State is an enum with three values, empty, in progress, and ready. Isource is an interface which will have a state property and two methods. Produce, which accepts a dictionary of collectible items with ints and a single collectible item which is going to be produced. The second one is also a void called collect. Now, head to the field script and implement the isource interface. Move the state property to the top of the script. Also, add a crop field's current crop and a timer field. Go to the produce method. First, check the state for being empty. If it is not, return. Then, check if an item passed is an actual crop. Assign that crop to the current crop field. Then, go through each item in the items needed dictionary and check if the storage has enough. Write something in debug, or you can actually prompt the player to buy the necessary item, and then return. After this, we have to take the items, but we don't have this method yet in our storage system, so we're going to leave it as a to-do. Next, set the current state to in progress. Change the sprite to growing. Now, add a timer component to this object and save it in a field. Initialize it with the current crop name, date time now, and the production time also from the crop. Add a listener to the timer finished event. In it, change the state to ready, change the sprite to grow, destroy, and nullify the timer. Outside this block, call the start timer method. You can have more states actually, but I decided to keep it simple so I don't have to create more fields and also not to complicate things for you. After this, go to the collect method. We would also have to return to it when we finish the storage system. After this, change the state to empty. Bring back the empty field sprite and set the current crop to null. Now, in the onClick method, create a switch with current state. If the field is empty, display the items tooltip with all the crops. If it is in progress, display the timer tooltip. If it is ready, display the collect tooltip. Also, we have to go to the distributor script and call the produce method in onCollide method. And do the same in collector, calling the collect instead. Now you can hit play mode and test things out. As you can see, we have the field item in the shop, which we can place in the map. It is empty at the moment, so when clicking on it, we get an item's tooltip with all the crops. When a crop is growing, we can see the timer. And when it's ready, the sprite changes and we can collect this crop. Looks like we're done for this episode. Thank you for watching. Now, we have a field that can grow crops and a base for other systems like animal produce and gardening. In the next episode, we're going to finish this storage system and make another engaging mechanic for our project. So subscribe to my channel and hit that like button if you enjoyed watching this video. And don't forget to check out my Discord server where you can share your work, chat with me and other game devs. I want to thank all my patrons for supporting me and welcome new members, especially J01CEB8X, Pot and Keg, Chao Thang Thang, Kershivir Yitu, Kershivir YT, Viral Marcel. See you in the next video! Bye!